So, have you ever noticed how an ice skater spins faster when she pulls her arms in? What really is the secret behind this? So, by the end of this lesson, you'll uncover the physics behind this motion and see how the same principle applies to everything from spinning planets to atomic particles. So, the equation torque net is equal to dL upon dt is Newton's second law in its angular form. Now, let's carefully examine what this equation tells us. So, if left-hand side of this equation becomes zero, which essentially means no net external torque acts on the system, this equation reduces to dL upon dt is equal to zero. And simple calculus tells us that if the derivative of a quantity is zero, then the quantity itself must be a constant. So what we see is that L is a constant here. And this is nothing but the law of conservation of angular momentum. And as a formal statement, we can say that if the net external torque acting on a system is zero, the angular momentum L of the system will not change or remain constant, regardless of any internal changes within the system. So, if we measure L at some time ti and again at a later time tf, the values should be identical, or L initial should equal L final. And you would have noticed that this sounds so similar to the law of conservation of linear momentum, where we say that if there is no external force acting on a system, the linear momentum is conserved or does not change. Also, you need to remember that both these equations are vector equations since angular momentum is a vector quantity. This also means that conservation of angular momentum applies separately along each axis, that is x, y, and z. In other words, L remains constant along any axis where the net external torque is zero. And this is an important statement, and so I will repeat. So L, or the angular momentum, remains constant along any axis if the net external torque is zero along that axis. Now, what if a torque does act on a system? The question to ask is, has the angular momentum changed? Well, based on what we've learned so far, the answer is clearly yes, it must change. However, if we are given additional information that this torque acted only along one of the axes, then what can we say about the change in angular momentum? So, what we can say now is that the torque will change the angular momentum only along that axis, and the angular momentum along the other two axes will remain unchanged. That is to say, the way torque acts on a system, the angular momentum of the system might not change in only one or two directions, but definitely not in all directions. That is, it will change in at least one of the directions if an external torque acts on a system. Well, you can say the same thing in another way. And listen carefully. That is, if the component of the external torque on the system along a certain axis is zero, then the component of angular momentum of the system along that axis will not change. So, let us apply this law to an isolated body like this, where we can see that it is rotating around the z-axis, and let us say its moment of inertia is I initial and the angular velocity is omega initial. Now, what happens is that the mass of this body gets redistributed relative to the rotation axis, and therefore the rotational inertia about that axis also changes. And we are also told that no external torque has acted on the system. Well, this equation tells us that the angular momentum of this body cannot change simply because no torque has acted on the system. Then, writing L again as I final times omega final, these two terms must be equal. That is, angular momentum is conserved. Another interesting thing to know about this law is that this law is true beyond the limitations of Newtonian mechanics. That is, it holds true for a particle whose speed approaches that of light, where the theory of special relativity comes into play, and it remains true in the world of subatomic particles as well, where quantum physics explains the behavior of a particle. And no exceptions whatsoever have been found to this law of conservation of angular momentum, and that's what makes it very powerful. So now we will try to use this law to understand what really is happening when an ice skater rotating freely pulls her arm in and the consequent change in her spin velocity. So what you have here is an ice skater rotating at a slow initial angular speed omega I, and her hands are outstretched. Now when she pulls her arms and legs in, what really is happening is that her rotational inertia is reducing from its initial value I initial to a smaller value I final, simply because you see her body mass has now moved closer to the axis of rotation. And when this happens, what we find is that her rotational speed increases from omega initial to omega final. Okay, so how do we explain this increase in angular velocity using the law of conservation of angular momentum? So first off, we can see that no net external torque has acted on the ice skater, and therefore the angular momentum of the ice skater about the rotation axis has to remain constant, or I initial times omega initial should equal I final times omega final. So what has happened here is that as the moment of inertia of the skater reduced when she pulled her hands in, her angular velocity increased, so that this product remained the same as before. That is, the initial and the final angular momentum remained the same in accordance with the law of conservation of angular momentum. And this precise control over rotational motion is what allows top ice skaters to perform at the highest level, executing breathtaking spins with incredible speeds and precision. So if you want to learn more about angular variables, rolling motion and rotation, I would suggest you head over to this playlist, which has all the videos you need to excel in this topic. And if you like this lesson, do give it a thumbs up, and I'll see you in the next lesson.